Welcome back to the International Export Conference on China with Invest Northern Ireland. I'm Richard Seymour, Regional Director, managing a team of experienced business professionals across China. During the course of this session, we will outline how and where Invest Northern Ireland can help Northern Ireland companies to enter and succeed in the region. This session will focus on education and creative industry in China. During the course of this presentation, I'll be outlining how and where Invest Northern Ireland assists Northern Irish companies in the region and the range of services we provide to help your organisation enter and succeed in new markets. Invest Northern Ireland's role is to educate and inform you about opportunities to export and to provide financial and advisory assistance, both domestically in Northern Ireland and in markets, to help companies explore new markets. We help you to make informed decisions, to understand if a market is attractive to you, and if your company has the capability and resources to export to new regions and locations. And once a decision to export has been made, we will support you in successfully executing your in-market strategy. We provide in-market business development activities, attending exhibitions, expos, workshops and conferences at key industry events throughout the calendar year, at which we represent Northern Irish companies, generate business leads, set up B2B meetings, and identify future sales opportunities through networking. Invest Northern Ireland in overseas markets provides a range of assistance to Northern Ireland exporters on the ground across four large territories globally, namely the Americas, India, Middle East and Africa, Europe, and of course, Asia Pacific, a region in which we are making significant investment. In Asia Pacific, we are divided into five regions: mainland China, which we are focusing on today in this export conference, Hong Kong, Northeast Asia, Australia and New Zealand, and Southeast Asia, including Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, Vietnam, and Indonesia. Our dedicated team of business development professionals work throughout Asia. In short, we are your local business partner overseas. Today, we have offices in mainland China, in Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, with a team operating out of key embassies and consulates across the region. These trained professionals will be sharing their expertise and insights in the next part of the seminar, cover the following sectors: advanced manufacturing and engineering, education, food and drink, life and health sciences. We are currently exploring expanding the sectoral coverage in 2022 to include some form of specific coverage for the ICT sector. However, while our sector-focused strategy currently concentrates on these four main areas, we will react and provide assistance to all the inquiries we receive. Invest Northern Ireland also works in close collaboration with key organisations, such as the NI Bureau, to build long-term relationships, gain market access, while capitalising and creating opportunities with regional and provincial actors at the highest levels of government. So, how do we work with our client companies? In Asia Pacific and China, we have further developed the trusted business partner relationship adopted by INI in Northern Ireland to encompass the activity and the key relationships you have with you in markets in China. Most importantly, you, the client company, is the centre of this relationship. You will be supported by a locally based INI client manager and the international trade advisor from our Belfast headquarters, or one of six regional offices, the China-based team, our China advisory support provider, and other in-market partners will all work with you to provide assistance, advice, professional business development activity, and active on-the-ground support. Let's take a closer look at the roles of the INI team that is here to help you. Your client manager, based in Northern Ireland, concentrates on key sectors, giving you unique industry knowledge and the confidence to expand your business. Our international trade advisors are similarly sector-focused, with a track record of successfully helping Northern Irish companies export worldwide. While the in-market team deliver on-the-ground expertise, local knowledge, and industry connections across China, which are enhanced by strong government contacts and connections from the British Embassy and the consulate network in China. And finally, our ITA, BD team, and you, the client, will work closely with our trade advisory support, or TAS provider, to assist with research to fully inform your market entry and connect you to businesses via industry channels across the country. This experienced team work with a single focus in mind: to support you, the client. We provide in-market BD activities, attending exhibitions, expos, workshops and conferences at key industry events throughout the calendar year, at which we represent the Northern Irish companies, generate business leads, set up B2B meetings, and identify future sales opportunities through networking. We provide cutting-edge insights, including specialist IP knowledge on how to protect your brand, and give financial support to businesses seeking to export. Our world-class sectoral research, or company-specific research, allows you to make informed decisions and optimize your offering for China. Our extensive network provides clients with access to industry associations and regional influencers at the highest level. This suite of services is complemented by localized and nationwide marketing and communications delivered across multi-channels and multi-sector marketing for client companies. In addition, our in-market teams keep abreast of the impacts of policy changes and sectoral developments, enabling them to understand implications, risks, and in-market business opportunities. This knowledge is particularly critical in China, where the government plays a key role in sectoral developments and policy intervention. So, why consider exporting to China? The China opportunity is vast. China has a population of over 1.4 billion people with a burgeoning middle class and a $14.7 trillion economy in 2020. Notably, the only economy to experience growth last year. Indeed, despite one quarter of negative growth in 2020 during the pandemic, China went on to record a full year of growth, and economists in a recent Reuters poll expect an 8.6% GDP expansion in 2020. However, China remains a challenging market, ranking 31 out of 191 countries on the World Bank Ease of Doing Business Index. China is currently pursuing a dual circulation development strategy, aiming to drive domestic demand while strengthening China's capability to undertake global trade. A strategy, according to analysts, that will see China's economy become increasingly self-reliant while minimizing the effects of potential fluctuations in the global economy. State-backed enterprises and Chinese government involvement in industry may also create challenges for foreign businesses competing openly in individual markets. However, crucially, China is the world's second largest importer of goods and one of the world's fastest growing economies, which has been predicted to become the world's largest as early as 2028. Put simply, it is an economy in which opportunities abound, and we are helping you to capitalize on these opportunities in a number of ways. We do this through a journey of exploration, growth, and achievement. Investor and I has developed a methodology that we call a trade journey, a continuous stream of activity over a significant period of time, producing strong results. First, we educate you, our NI client company, about the opportunity and how to access that opportunity. Then we work hand in hand with single companies or cohorts of companies to make initial sales. We call that the nail it phase. Next, we enter the final phase, scale it, where we build on the achievements and successful case studies to scale your business geographically and expand into new sales channels. So, educate, nail it, and scale it. Three simple phases, but as you can imagine, more complex to execute than they sound. For many of you, this may be your first steps into understanding China. In the next part of this conference, you will hear more about each of the sector-focused trade journeys, but let me take this opportunity to explain this three-phase trade journey approach. In the first phase, to explore the market and sector in China, we invest time to understand Northern Ireland's sectoral capability, capacity, and existing export sectors. We meet with you, our Northern Irish companies, to understand your products and business model, to understand the challenges of each sector and the aspirations of your business. Our sectorially focused China team work with you and our domestic-based INI colleagues to evaluate your individual company needs and the needs of the sector in NI, to conduct sector research, but also client-focused research designed specifically for you. Whilst our approach is not an exhibition-driven strategy, we do leverage exhibitions and trade shows. We think of these as another activity along the journey of exploration and business development. We commit resources and build key relationships with important local industry partners, experts and distributors, and perhaps most importantly, we are even at this stage focused on generating commercial outcomes for you, where we work with you to develop B2B meetings, both before, during, and after trade shows and exhibitions, and align Marcom's activity to this business development activity undertaken in China. With this continuous stream of activity and engagement, you are able to make an informed investment decision on the viability of China as a suitable export market. In short, we provide you with optionality. Obviously, this cannot be a one-size-fits-all strategy or process, but as we near the end of phase one and enter phase two, where initial sales are generated, we consider and assist with distributor and dealer searches, customer and sales channel development, stakeholder engagement, market access issues, and can contribute to your go-to-market strategy. As your China business develops and you become more confident in your knowledge and commitment to the market, you will then start to think of scaling your China business. In this phase, again, Invest Northern Ireland has a strong role to play. Scaling businesses in China can involve expanding within China to other geographical areas, the development of multiple sales channels and product differentiation. Given the government policy-led environment in China and its recognition of its size, we continue to work with you to maintain and develop your stakeholder engagement and marketing and communication activity. The most important thing to take away is that Invest Northern Ireland has made the investment in markets and in Northern Ireland, has sector experts and a suite of services and the imagination required to use these to provide bespoke and sectorially driven support in a continuous stream of engagement that leads to commercial outcomes. And that concludes our introduction to Invest Northern Ireland in Asia Pacific and China. Should you have any questions or need further information, please do not hesitate to contact us. Our next speaker is in-market sector lead Summer Song. Summer will be highlighting the importance of the China market, share her extensive work supporting Northern Irish companies in China, and provide details of future events for your participation. We hope you enjoy the session.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Summer Song. I am the sector lead for education and the creative industry, and I have been building strong connections between education establishments in Northern Ireland and China for many years. I am based in Beijing, and prior to joining Invest Northern Ireland, I worked for some of the world's leading organizations in education, including the Cambridge Assessment, which is a department of the University of Cambridge, and the British Council. I hope to share some insights into the education market with you today. Education is an essential sector contributing strong economic value from China to Northern Ireland. Historically, we have focused strategically on higher education, the universities, because China is the largest contributor of the international students in Northern Ireland. It's a dynamic sector. So today, I will share some of the work we have undertaken, as well as what we will do in the coming months. First of all, let's take a look at why education is a pillar sector between Northern Ireland and China. Northern Ireland has one of the best education systems in Europe. The lowest unemployment rate in the UK has also proved NI's success in our education. Northern Ireland has a wealth of education resources. It is now with a more active presence and has become more influential in China market. In higher education institutes, China is the largest contributor of international students to Northern Ireland. The number of the new Chinese students in 2019 to 2020 academic year has increased by 24%, up to 1,680 new Chinese students, while the new students from the States is only 125. New students from China have contributed an economic value of at least £53 million. Combined with existing Chinese students in Northern Ireland, altogether they contributed up to £170 million to the local economy. Northern Ireland has been consistently outperforming the other UK regions at GCSE and A-level examinations. This is a great story to attract Chinese international schools and investors. This will also benefit the teachers' training programs in Northern Ireland. We have 7 active players in Northern Ireland providing high quality teachers and leadership training programs. The TVET sector, the vocational education, is also enjoying favorable policy in China since 2019, with more support and funding from the Chinese government. And also the preschool sector will benefit from the third child policy announced in May 2021. Lastly, we can also build soft power via education, which I will share with you a story towards the end of my presentation. Next, I would like to highlight how we can support your business expansion or market entrance in China. In general, there are 6 categories as shown on our screen now. We've been actively educating the market via carefully selected professional platforms in the past few years. We found it very efficient to promote our education resources as a region rather than promoting each program individually. The concept of a region has scaled up the influence greatly, especially when the voice is from a government body. We are familiar with local education media channels, so feel free to contact us and we can share some of our experiences and understanding in prevailing Chinese social media platforms. For events and exhibitions, I'll take everyone to review some of our events we have funded in the next couple of slides. For stakeholder engagement, I think InvestNI is playing a more essential role while the international traveling is restricted. For example, I have delivered some of the keynote speeches at several key industry conferences to represent our education programs in Northern Ireland. This including the China Education Expo, the UK-China Teachers Education Forum, Sino-Europe Vocational Education Seminar, Global Education Technology Summit, etc. We also actively meet up with government bodies to explore G2G collaboration opportunities. We introduced the Shandong Provincial Department of Education to our Northern Ireland universities for transnational education programs. We also worked very closely with Northeast China Foreign Affairs offices, with Shenyang CCPIT, Chengdu Jintang Vocational Education City, etc., to understand their demand in education. For research, we've led and purchased several industry reports. We've done research in South China and also Indonesia. We also collect local policy updates and share with our clients. Overall, for in-market business development, I think InvestNI's in-country team is taking a more essential role now than ever. We have consistently visited our local universities, education institutes, and commercial clients in China to observe what areas they will need the help from Northern Ireland, and also to share our finding with Northern Ireland. So we welcome our education clients to better utilize this support. Here's a generic trade journey for a Northern Ireland education company. We start from market evaluation. We've done education competitors analysis and market evaluation. The UK education brand is very welcomed in China market and also among the Chinese parents. That also means we have strong competitors within the UK. For example, we have over 60 British school campuses across China, but only one of them is a Northern Ireland school brand. But we also have our strengths. For example, our outstanding teacher training programs, our universities have the best value for money solutions in the UK, as the living expenditures in Northern Ireland is more reasonable than any other regions of the UK. Our TVET colleges have formed an alliance as Northern Ireland colleges, the synergy of which will amplify the influence. In step 2 to 4, you can see that we help our clients to do research and marketing. We also fund key education events in China, which I will share with you a few examples very soon. In step 5, we provide one-to-one support. Invest and I will tailor-made consultation for each education company. We are always willing to share the network with NI clients. Some successful one-to-one support examples including Ulster University and Beijing Normal University, QUB and Dalian Foreign Language University's collaboration in music production and Irish study, and also QUB and Beijing Normal University's collaboration in education. The early years organizations China Development and also the Rainy Endowed School Hangzhou campus launching and rebranding, etc. In short term, we help NI companies to generate export wins, while in the long run, we position Northern Ireland as a region representing the highest quality of the whole UK education. Now let's take a look at some of the education events we participated. Firstly is the CEE, the China Education Expo. CEE is one of the most influential education exhibition tours hosted by CEAIE under the Ministry of Education. InvestNI has led several seminars to promote NI higher education institutes and colleges during the CEE. This year, the UK will be the hosting country of CEE, which means more opportunities to expose during this national-wide event. Investor and I will work together with British Council to ensure Northern Ireland universities and colleges will get a very good presence, not only face-to-face, but also online when traveling is no longer convenient, not only to individual students and families, but also to business partners, including international schools and agents. The photo at the right food corner is a snapshot of last year's CEE live streaming session. Two year one students from Ulster University have live streamed their life in Northern Ireland during the COVID-19. This has attracted around 1,500 school-based university application counselors in China. Secondly, here's an event targeting international schools teachers training. Invest NI has co-hosted the UK-China Teachers Development and Training Forum attached to the TIDE conference. I have delivered a keynote speech to promote NI teachers' education programs. Invest NI, DIT, Study USA, and other government bodies in China have participated in the TIDE conference. I have also been invited to join a panel discussion to share the highlights of Northern Ireland teachers' training programs. Two WeChat posts were sent before and after the conference to drive traffic to and to enhance our influence. This is a TVET event on the vocational education. In 2019, the Chinese State Council has published a series of new policies to support vocational education in China. Most colleges in China have sufficient budget to purchase UK services. NI Colleges, with its unique resources, combines the six TVET colleges in Northern Ireland together, is very competitive and attractive. During the last China-UK Education Cooperation Forum, 48 MOUs were signed, and training workshops have been delivered in Northern Ireland. We are now actively exploring online and OMO, which means online merged with offline delivery of the training workshops with Chinese colleges. Even though the alliance synergy seems to be very appealing to Chinese vocational education colleges, there are obvious challenges too. Invest NI's role is to observe this market and make Northern Ireland vocational education colleges be aware of these business opportunities. We also run various education events to raise NI Education's profile in general and help NI education companies to expand their network. For example, the NI Education Reception is a high-end education event to promote our education resources with invited professional participants only. It's held in the Ambassador's Residence in Beijing. We also explore the trusted and effective social media channels to promote our programs. So clients are very welcome to discuss with us to utilize the opportunities. Education is a sector in which we can easily develop strong cultural connections and build Northern Ireland's soft power and positive influence. Invest NI has endeavored to establish positive media coverage through education and enhance the influence of soft power. Back in February 2020, when China was suffering from the outbreak of COVID-19, pupils from Melbourne Primary School in Coleraine recorded a Chinese song, "Let the World Be Full of Love." The video has quickly went global and was widely broadcasted in China. The China CCTV, China Daily, and even the China's State Council have all reported this news. In return, Invest NI led Chongqing Depu Foreign Language School to record their version of Danny Boy to show their thanks and support to Northern Ireland and UK during the global fight against the COVID-19. This has also been widely broadcasted in the UK and China. BBC, ITV, and the Chinese Consulate General in Belfast, they have all reposted this story. The story created very positive influence and support to the PPE procurement from China to Northern Ireland later in 2020. You may have seen the videos before. If not, you will see the video at the end of our session. Over the past few years, The Invest NI China team has been actively building positive internet footprints in China. Northern Ireland is becoming an increasingly popular overseas study destination for Chinese students. Chinese international students' number to Northern Ireland has increased by 23% annually since 2018. So before we finish, let's take a look at some of the upcoming education events in China. We planned another round of Markham's campaign on British Consul China's official WeChat account. This is to promote Northern Ireland education in general and to leave a positive internet footage about Northern Ireland's education. The RACE conference will take place in November 2021. It focuses on the international school-related opportunities. For example, the teachers' training, educational leadership development, UK's all-around education programs in arts, music, drama, sports, or STEM, etc. The Higher Education Mission. This is the event to explore university partnerships. Our colleges and universities can let us know if you would like to join this event. The event is planned to take place in Nanjing, covering the Yangtze Delta region of China in February next year. We will also work together with British Council to deliver a Northern Ireland-focused seminar during CEE 2021 in Beijing. This year, as I mentioned, UK will be the hosting country, and we appreciate the synergy working together with British Council in reaching out audience face-to-face. Northern Ireland has such fascinating education resources that we are all proud of. We aim to build our regions as an education highland of the UK or even the whole Europe. I look forward to hearing and learning from our education companies in Northern Ireland and will be very happy to share my knowledge too. Thank you very much. Next, we would like to share a successful case study. We have the great pleasure to have Pauline Wamsley with us today. Pauline is the CEO of Early Years in Northern Ireland, and she will share their successful development journey in China. We have also invited Claire Tan from Department for International Trade in China to share education policy updates and insights. Now over to you, Pauline.
Minister, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Early Years team, thank you for the opportunity to share our journey and our collaborations with China at this International Export Conference. Early Years, the organisation for young children formed in 1965, is a key partner in the delivery of early childhood education and care services in Northern Ireland. Our mission to promote and develop high quality, evidence-informed early childhood services for children, their families and communities. Our members serve over 30,000 children and families daily and employ almost 10,000 staff across the sectors involved. We are recognised nationally and internationally with engagement in over 50 countries across the world. This includes a number of international networks that showcase our evidence of what works and adapts this for use in other countries. Early Years is passionate in supporting the power of early childhood development and its contribution to the Sustainable Development Goals in reducing inequalities and peace building. Early Years brings enormous strength to engaging in China, including a reputation for quality, advocacy and influence, a focus on local community-based structure and local presence, an innovative and flexible organisation with a focus on research-based evidence and the link with quality, learning and care, and a dedicated and knowledgeable staff team. For us, partnership is key and underpins everything we do. With over 25 years' experience of international partnerships, we know we are trusted, respected, and valued partners. The focus of early years is evidence-based practice throughout the early childhood care and education field. We draw from research and academic studies to develop quality, innovative practice which supports services delivered for young children. On the ground, our experts provide ongoing support and advice to early childhood education and care settings on an individual, group, or peer network basis. We ensure that children are immersed in active learning environments and are also well supported with leadership, governance, and financial advice. We advocate, mobilise, and influence early years policy developments that are rights-based, evidence-informed, and appropriately resourced to deliver positive outcomes for young children. Over the past 56 years, with our members, we have continued to speak up for children, their families, and the early childhood care and education sector. We deliver a wide range of training programmes, professional learning events, and these are designed to improve practice by applying an appropriate, play-based, evidence-informed curriculum. Our training is designed for all early years practitioners, educators, teachers, leaders, managers, and parents working with young children in early education and care settings. Our training helps develop the confidence and competence of the participants in the understanding of learning through play and the holistic needs of young children. So to China. China has experienced rapid growth in preschool provision in line with policies aimed at meeting Sustainable Development Goal targets for universal preschool provision for 3 to 6 year olds. There is growing demand for childcare services for children birth to 3, and that's set to increase further by the recent 3-child policy. There is a dire shortage of preschool teachers and practitioners in China. Therefore, a huge potential to develop evidence-based early childhood education and care initiatives in China, both birth to 3 and the preschool 3 to 6 year old phase, that are specifically adapted for the Chinese market. There is a need to engage with multiple partners to define the market and explore the opportunity. For partnerships, setting shared targets and clearly defined roles and responsibilities is essential. Our approach has been to test the market with small trial approaches, many of which have been delivered jointly in our case. We then work with our partners to refine the offering based on feedback and move to develop longer term contractual agreements. Some of the highlights from our journey. Colour Baby in the Hebei province participated in a study tour to Northern Ireland and visited early years and a number of early years high school settings. As a result of this, early years began training in Hebei over a 3-year period. Early years took part in the DIT Education is Great mission to China in September 2017. We met a range of stakeholders and networked with numerous organisations, including InvestNI in China. And I suppose this was the real beginning of traction and of our collaboration with InvestNI in China through initially Monica Wren and in more recent times with Summer Song. Chinese stakeholders were very excited to network and very highly motivated to seek cooperation opportunities on the establishment of high quality childcare and preschool, opportunities for training teachers, curriculum and content cooperation, education technology, amongst other things. And the week's events took place in Beijing, Shanghai, and Shenzhen, allowing our delegation to meet stakeholders from across China. With over 650 delegates from different backgrounds in attendance, we were able to make lots of connections. Results included collaborations with Morningstar Education Company, and early years trainers travelled to Shanghai in June 2019 and delivered training in three locations to over 500 participants. And this was highlighted as a key success to many kindergartens across that network and across China. Following further introductions by InvestNI, we continue through 2021 to deliver virtual curriculum webinars, leadership and management courses to kindergarten managers, owners, directors, leaders and staff. Following the Tide InvestNI Trade Fair in June of 21, Early Years and Rainey linked and formed a partnership. We also, from January 2022, will contribute to professional learning strand of the Early Years Kindergarten section of the Asia International School run by the Harrow Academy. And so, I suppose, to the support that InvestNI has provided. And this has been invaluable. It's included introducing potential customers in China since 2016. More importantly, introducing business partners. And we found the Tides Trade Fair really, really important in terms of that. Promoting early years programs at influential events, providing information and advice, and more recently, in terms of the provision of legal and trade support and advice. And in particular, we would like to express our thanks to Summer for the ongoing support and advice provided. As a fledgling in the China market, we've also had great support from the team here in Northern Ireland as well. And indeed, we look forward to continuing and strengthening our relationship with Summer and her contacts in InvestNI in China. I think going forward, that is going to be even more critical for us, and particularly in terms of the specialist business support and legal issues that we now need advice in relation to. We look forward to working with InvestNI in terms of that. Going forward, we think it's also important to pay attention to partnership and ensure that those partnerships are high performing and agile partnerships. In order to do that, we focus on clear communication channels, effective structures, and roles and responsibilities that are articulated and well understood. I think it's really important that there's trust within a partnership to be able to share learning between both partners and to inform and manage the improvement processes for both parties. This is a fast-changing, dynamic environment within China, and I think that level of trust needs to exist between partners, and we need to be able to act quickly. It's also important that we always keep exploring opportunities for new partnerships, and it is all about networking, connecting, and celebrating and promoting our successes. Finally, I want to leave you with the contact details for early years, And hopefully we look forward to working with many of you in the future and supporting a lifelong learning journey for stakeholders in China. Thank you.
Many thanks to Pauline for such an interesting presentation. We wish early years every success. Next, we will focus on recent educational policy changes in China. In June this year, China's Ministry of Education announced a series of policy restricting local tutorial businesses. As a result, there has been a wide range of opinion and analysis surrounding the impacts of these policies, including the well-known double relief policy. It is a policy which actually targets and has implications for China-based core subject tutorial providers, including English, mathematics, and Chinese tutorials. The impact of the double relief policy, while strongly felt in China, is by no means a barrier to entry for Northern Irish companies in education sector. Furthermore, in comparison, opportunities and collaborations with international partners in preschool, vocational education, arts and sports still remain quite open. In our next presentation, Claire Tan from the Department for International Trade in China will share her insights and examine the content of this policy. Welcome, Claire.
Hello, everyone. This is Claire Tan. I'm the head of English Language Training, Market Access and Policy at DIT China Education Skills Team. Today, I'm going to talk about the double relief policy, which was issued by China in late July. I'm going to go a little bit deep into how the policy looks like. What does it mean to you? What we can do for you? So first, let's quickly have a look on the summary of the policy. So basically, on 24th of July, China State Council and the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party announced the so-called double relief policy, full name of which is Opinions on Further Reducing the Burden of Homework and Off-Campus Training for Students in Compulsory Education. It seeks to ease the burden of homework and after-school classes on students in compulsory education. The publication of this policy is made by the two general offices, including the state and party system. So in terms of what the opinion says, I've listed eight items here to help you understand the overall situation instead of reading headlines from the media. So the first one is like the opinion regulates after-class learning, both on and off school campuses, for students in compulsory education, which means years 1 to 9 in China. And also this opinion controls and reduce homework burdens apart from the after school training bit. The opinion really boosts the role of on-campus after school classes in both subject learning and all round education. The subject learning is a core content under the national curriculum with all-round education, including sports, music, arts, IT, and technology. Schools may extend finishing hours to 6 p.m. to cover all-round education, and local governments should offer online educational resources free of charge to improve equality of access to high-quality education. Meanwhile, the opinion also sets a very tough regulatory regime for the private off-campus education, including re-registration of new off-campus subject-focused tutoring providers suspension. And also the existing providers are required to reapply to gain the government approval. Otherwise, they will lose their ICP license. In terms of foreign investments and raising capital on stock market, it is also prohibited for compulsory education off-campus subject tutoring providers, which means you cannot do an M&A and VIE structures, which you already used to do. The opinion also restricts after-school learning time in off-campus classes and regulates teaching content teachers. So all teachers must have relevant qualifications and be hired according to the Chinese regulation. Expat teachers who are based abroad cannot be engaged in online provision. Additionally, the opinion requires all regions to categorize all-round education provision into sports, culture, and arts, science, and technology, among others, clarify the responding regulatory bodies, and also to formulate the standards and each provide licensed strictly. Last but not least, the opinion also sets government structures and clear implementation timelines. The policy must be carried out nationwide within 1 year, with significant improvements made within 3 years. So to give you a wider context and the policy aims, the opinion is really a part of a major series of education reforms in China, which is collectively reshaping both public schools and the private education sector. And also the opinion is also wide-ranging and aligned with a number of separate Chinese policy priorities. So for example, in terms of K-12 stage, we have seen a new law, which is the private education promotion law, was issued on May the 14th by Ministry of Education in China. It was actually effective from September the 1st, which means private schools from kindergarten to grade 9 will be barred from using foreign curricula or having foreign nationals taking ownership, control our corporate decisions. We also saw on the 1st of June, the law of the law on protection of minors became effective. This also banned after-school tutoring organized by all K-9 schools during holidays and weekends, and also primary school level tutoring organized by kindergarten and private institutes. But in contrast, the policies in terms of TVET worlds are more like green lights. For example, in April this year, China's National Vocational Education Conference was held in Beijing. The importance of this is that it was actually the first ever National Vocational Education Conference held by CCT Central Committee and State Council since the founding of the People's Republic of China. And also in early June, we have seen a draft revision to vocational education law was discussed by the Chinese legislature in June 2021. For example, let's come back to the policy we were talking about today, the reaction. So first, we're talking about the stresses on Chinese students. We have seen a survey by China National Children's Center in 2019 showed that 60% of children under 15 received off-campus training, and for an average of 3.4 hours Monday to Friday and 3.2 hours during the weekend. And also this opinion led to a very swift reaction in financial markets, including the collapse of the share prices of companies listed in New York, Hong Kong, and mainland China. I think most of you were familiar with this, including like leading players like New Oriental and TAL. They all experienced a large sell-off. So let's come to the maybe the most important bit for you. What does it mean for you when you are looking to explore China market? The policy is mainly to really look at the domestic market players to regulate the after-school subject tutoring markets. But we should also admit that foreign supply will be indirectly impacted because our potential buyers may have been hit hard by this policy. And secondly, the implementation of this opinion will be challenging. And as you can imagine, the success in the short term is not certain. But I would like to raise some opportunities in terms of TVET, as I illustrated before, the policy support, and also the huge number of schools running TVET in China. Secondly is, of course, the all-round education and EdTech. The policy reinforces the school's leading positions in providing on-campus after-curricular programs to students. You could watch on finding the right partners in China to really tap in the school's provision. One point I would like to make here, this uncertainty and challenging situation means that you can talk to us at DIT and also our friends in Western Northern Ireland who can also provide significant support you may need when you are looking for opportunities in China. So basically, that's what I'd like to say today. If you have any questions, please do get in touch with us. I've listed my email address here. Thank you.
Thank you to Summer Song from Invest Northern Ireland, Pauline Walmsley from Early Years, and Claire Tam from the Department of Industry and Trade for their presentations, and for sharing their knowledge and experience of China's education and creative industry sector. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact us. Now we'll hear from Colin Graham, Technical Advisor at the Invest Northern Ireland Technical Advisory Unit in Belfast. Colin brings extensive experience in providing intellectual property advice, financial support, and guidance to Northern Irish companies entering markets overseas, and will highlight how Invest Northern Ireland can help prepare your company for export success.
Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure to be speaking to you all today. My name is Colin Graham, and I work in the Technical Advisory Unit within Invest Northern Ireland. Within that team, there's a mixture of engineers and scientists and people with an intellectual property background, and we aim to help mostly small and medium-sized companies with a variety of different problems, IP, product development, quality management systems, and others. But today's really primarily about intellectual property, so that's where I'm going to focus. Within the technical advisory unit at InvestNI, we have some expertise in advising companies on the issues to look out for in different markets, but we're going to start off with the focus on China, obviously. But in general terms, we can provide advice and guidance on intellectual assets, intellectual property protection issues. So that ranges across patents, trademarks, design registrations, copyright, license agreements, and so on. We have the capability to do patent searches, both internationally and domestically, and trademark searches, and we have access to an international database where we can check on trademarks for companies free of charge within reason. We don't have an unlimited capacity to do that, but we can certainly do that for any companies where it may be helpful. We also can deliver intellectual asset audits, and that allows us to take a look at what intellectual assets a company may possess, look at the level of protection that they have on those, and see if that's appropriate and if it's providing coverage in the key important markets that you're dealing in. So it's worth pointing out, though, we're not legally qualified in intellectual property. We're not lawyers, but over the last 10, 15 years, we've certainly acquired considerable experience in helping small and medium enterprises, particularly with the appropriate way to handle intellectual property and intellectual asset challenges within their companies, both in the UK market and as they start their export journey. So most of our work would center on helping InvestNI client companies to register trademarks or patents in the UK and the EU, and also to quite a large extent in the US. But we have increasingly been involved in helping companies with intellectual asset registrations and issues in China, Japan, Indonesia, Australia, and the rest of the world, like South America and so on. We can also supplement our own knowledge and experience with linking people into some of the IP services companies that operate in Northern Ireland or beyond, and that can be helpful in letting people to access those services as they need them. So let me throw up to start with some basic issues to consider before we even focus on China itself. So we'll take one step backwards, as it were, and I'm going to pose the question, do you know within your company at present, is your intellectual property appropriately protected in the UK or within the EU, what you might consider your home markets? Because we've had examples in the past of people who thought that perhaps IP was only a big issue in China and didn't matter so much here. And obviously that isn't true. It's very important to have that base level of protection in your home markets in the UK and the Republic of Ireland, the rest of Europe. So I'll put that out there as a question. Do you know, do you understand what IP registrations you already have within your company? Does somebody have a list of those? Could they pull them out? Could they let us see when those expire, who you registered them with, what markets they're registered in? Are they purely logos? Are they descriptive? What classifications do you have them in, perhaps? there's no doubt that more and more, especially for small companies, that intellectual assets are probably one of their key assets in the company. The intangible assets like that continue to be more and more important than physical assets as we work in a more knowledge-based economy. So I think it's important just to take that one step back. Do you know what IP you have currently in the UK and EU? And do you know the dates of expiry and all of those things? Having reassured ourselves on that, and you've reassured yourselves on that, the fact that you have a trademark in your home markets does not help you in China and has no legal value in China. Trademarks in particular are geographically registered. So if you have a UK trademark, it will not cover you in other countries and certainly won't cover you in China. So perhaps a good starting point would be to do some searching, perhaps with one of the IP attorneys. Is the trademark you're thinking about using in China, is it available? Does any other company have it? So that, I think that has to be the starting point. Is it available? And as I said, we can do some of those searches for you if that's helpful. I think the one big point we want to make here is that it's very easy with the excitement of maybe looking at a business opportunity in China to think, let's go straight in there, let's do that. But the fact is, it can take up to 9 months or a year to register a trademark in China. So it's really important to think about this and to think about it at the earliest possible stage, and probably not when you're about to ship your first container of products to China. So please bear that in mind. The earliest point of thought about this is best. If you can think about it, you know, up to 9-10 months ahead, that would be excellent. But obviously business issues take precedence, and sometimes that's not always possible. But do think about it at the earliest possible opportunity and try to involve us or your IP advisors on checking, is the trademark you're thinking about available to register in that market? There is an issue that some people who are unfamiliar with selling into China may not be aware, and that's the fact that you can register English and Chinese language versions of your trademark. And sometimes that acts as a bit of a delay or a bit of a barrier, and people think that, well, we're not quite sure how to typify our product or our trademark in a Chinese language, so therefore we won't do it. But the basic advice we'd give is, if you're in that situation, which is understandable, at least get on with registering the English language version of your trademark and get that underway. Some other basics I want to throw in here as well. There are major risks in that have happened in the past, and there's some nasty stories about how importers have perhaps maliciously registered trademarks in advance. So it's important to register the trademark in your company's name. It may initially feel easier to get somebody, your local importer or whatever, to register it, but that could be very counterproductive in the long run and could be difficult, could create big difficulties, in fact, if a relationship breaks down in the future, if the business or trading relationship breaks down. It may be difficult or indeed impossible to get the trademark back, and you may have to deal with the consequences of that, which could be at best difficult and at worst impossible, I think. So as I mentioned before, it's important to register the trademark before a brand enters into China. There is this risk that Chinese companies can register overseas brands' trademarks in a spiteful way before the brand enters into China, not to speak of those brands that already are in China. So as I say, get the English trademark registration process underway, even if you're not sure about the Chinese language version. It's common that some brands, as I say, may not know how to typify their brand name in Chinese, but don't worry about that. Get the English version registered, because the trademark is owned by whoever registers it first, and that process can take 9 months to 12 months. Also worth pointing out as well that domain name registrations may be important as well, and they're separate, so you do need to pay attention to those as well as getting trademarks. The good news, hopefully, for some people is if you're involved in the registration of a trademark in China or some of the other export markets. If you're an SME, there may be some help available from Invest Northern Ireland to assist in that process. And to help towards that end, we use a scheme called Technical and Development Incentive, or TDI for short. That's only available to Invest NI clients, and you do have to be an SME, so in other words, employing 250 people or less in rough terms. That scheme can be used to help SMEs with things like product design, product approval, product compliance issues, and quality management systems. But quite often it is used for intellectual property and intellectual asset registrations. So for something like registering a trademark in China, it's a very well set up scheme and commonly used for that purpose. It can only be used for external third party costs. It can't be used to assist with in-house costs that you may incur, but typically that works perfectly fine because you're dealing with an IP attorney either in the UK or locally engaged in China. We don't mind which it is from the point of view of the TDI scheme and the support there. Any offers on that scheme are subject to approval by your normal client executive, but it can cover 50% of the project costs up to certain limits. So I'll just talk through those limits because they're worth bearing in mind. You could have a maximum grant of £10,000 using TDI support, which is more than ample to cover both a trademark logo and a trademark word representation. So that would certainly be valuable. You can have a maximum of 2 live TDI grants available within a rolling 12-month period, subject to normal approvals by your client executive. So if you've used those 2 and other things already this year, then it may not be open to you. But otherwise, it's normally pretty straightforward to do. There is an online application process, so we can assess those applications electronically and normally turn them around and move towards issuing an offer within 2 weeks. And as I say, the supplier can be located here at home, or they could be in China or elsewhere. We don't particularly mind as long as they're a credible organization, and we will review the quote before we'll issue a link to the application form to you. So that kind of concludes the main things I wanted to say. I just wanted to highlight some of those key issues about thinking about your trademark and your intellectual property issues in China before you get there. And ideally start thinking about them 9 months to a year ahead as you plan your market entry. Be very careful about letting someone else register your trademark. The general advice is don't do that. Register it in your own name. It's by far the best way forward. And certainly for the SMEs in the audience, we can provide that Invest NI support to help the process and provide our advice and guidance on things like trademark searching as you go through this process. That kind of summarizes what I want to say and what I want to encourage you to think about this morning. If you would like to get in touch to discuss any of that, you can directly contact me on that email address or my colleague Ian Wilkinson, who's the manager of the Technical Advisory Unit Invest NI. You can contact us on those email addresses, or by all means, you can make contact through your normal client executive if that's an easier process for you. Thanks for listening to me, and hopefully we'll be able to help a few with those inquiries, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you.
Thank you to Colin for a very insightful and informative presentation on intellectual property advice and guidance. Our next speaker is Ting-Ting Xu from the Confucius Institute at Ulster University. Ting-Ting's presentation will highlight some of the important cultural considerations to be aware of and the common mistakes to avoid when doing business in China. Over to Ting-Ting.
Good morning, everyone. First, thanks for Invest Northern Ireland for inviting me to join in this seminar. I'm delighted to be able to deliver this session today. My name is Ting-Ting, and I work for the Confucius Institute for Northern Ireland at Ulster University. And the topics I want to cover with you today are as follows. Business culture in China, which includes greetings, face and relationships, banquet and table manners, meetings, exchanging gifts, and lastly, business cards. And generally speaking, you can make a simple address and then shake hands with each other simultaneously with exchange greetings, 你好, which means hello, then exchanging business cards. You are supposed to pay much attention to the time and strength when shaking hands. It is inappropriate to shake hands for too long or too short a time. 3 to 5 seconds is the best. And next slide, I will teach you how to say hello in Mandarin. Here, 你, 你 means you, 好 means good. Together, 你好, which means hello. And when you say 你好, and the reply also 你好, 你好, 你好. And there are some tips when greeting others. In China, greet others by using handshake or not, and do address seniorities by the honorific title, their family relationship, for example, teacher, 老师, or by the family name plus Mr. 先生, Miss, 女士. And do address the eldest or most senior person first. This is done as a sign of respect to those in a more senior position. As for the concept of low contact cultures and the high contact cultures, which were first introduced by the anthropologist Edward T. Hall in his 1959 book, The Silent Language. And the low contact culture values efficiency, time, directness, honesty, clarity, and understanding. As for the high contact culture, which values body language, storytelling, saving face, rules of politeness, and relationship. As Chinese belong to high contact culture, which values relationship. And relationship, 关系, is closest to connections, networks, and relationship. Chinese people attach greater importance to the social relationships than the commercial relationship when doing business. 关系 means to establish personal trust and a strong relationship with your partner and can involve frequent visits and plenty of socializing. 关系 is your social capital within your network. Concepts like friends before business means you develop friendship before the business, because if you don't have friends, the business won't be there anyway. And the reciprocal nature of guanxi is the main reason why Chinese are reticent to engage in deeper relationships with people they do not know. Guanxi is hard to establish, but lasts long. It is a core trait of Chinese mentality. And as a foreigner, understanding what is meant by face can mitigate a culture shock. It can also help with relationship building between yourself and your Chinese colleagues. Face can be described as a combination of social standing, reputation, influence, dignity, and honor. A giving face is crucial when it comes to do business in China. If you give Chinese face, for the most part, what you receive in return is much greater. And no face means disrespect or losing face. And throughout a Chinese person's life, face must be maintained and enhanced through giving to and receiving from others in both words and actions. And here are some tips for giving face. Praising someone publicly, especially in front of their elders or boss, and giving sincere compliments and showing that you are enjoying yourself when being treated out. And the next part is also very important, which is a banquet. It is a channel for conducting business deals, although the practice varies depending on where you are and who you are dealing with. By and large, most Chinese banquet tables are round, and you will have a meal in a private room with harmonious and polite atmosphere. And for the traditional dining etiquette, if you are the guest, wait to be seated as hierarchy is involved. and eating usually begins when the host offers the first drink. When helping yourself to the dishes, you should take food first from plates in front of you rather than those in front of others. And here's a tip for you. Do not stick chopsticks vertically into your food, especially not into rice, as this will make Chinese think of funerals. And drinking toast, but light, not respond, but light, but respond toasts. And here are the seating orders. The first, the most important person sit the number one. And the second most important person sits number two. And the third most important person sit number three. And here also a picture for you. And for the chopsticks, which are called kuaizi in Chinese, while eating, watch to see if other diners are using their own chopsticks to take shared food, or if there is a spoon that is used to take the food from the communal dishes. And here are some taboos for the using of chopsticks during the meal. And do not knock on the bowl with chopsticks, and do not cross the chopsticks, and don't point your chopsticks at others. And also do not stick in the rice, which I mentioned just now. And during the banquet, there are several toasts. I say ganbei when toasting others to signify cheers. And locally produced wines or baijiu, which is strong liquor, are the usual drinks for toasts. And for formal dinner, the host will make a speech and toast. If there is a toast, remember each person's status in the hierarchy. And when delivering a toast, it's customary to stand and use both hands to hold your glass or cup, and it is respectful to dip the tip of your glass below that of the person you are toasting. And here are the etiquette for the meeting. The first is be punctual, which means you must be on time. Arriving late is considered rude. If you do arrive late, apologizing for your tardiness is a must. If you're hosting the meeting, it's proper etiquette to send the representative to greet the meeting's participants outside the building or in the lobby, and then personally escort them to the meeting room. And as for the seating arrangements at Chinese business, and the seating is typically arranged by rank, and the clothes dress formally. And here's the formal meeting. And next I want to talk about is about how to exchange gifts. It's a big part of any culture. And the ideal gift need not to be big or expensive. It should, however, be something that the recipient will appreciate. And when you receiving the gift, do you present with both hands and receive things with both hands? This is considered polite in Chinese culture. And do you gift a small item that are typical from your own region? And do not wrap gifts using black or white wrapping paper. Choose festive colors such as red instead, and do not overpackaging. Don't gift clocks or other symbolic items. And clocks and things are related to the number four are associated with death in China. Don't gift umbrellas, knives, scissors to your friends because this imply the severing of a relationship. And also do not expect that a gift will be opened immediately. And last tip that never give a green hat to a gentleman because it implies the association with adultery. And finally, I want to talk about how to exchange business cards. Here, my business cards, there are two sides. The first side is in English and the other side is in Mandarin or in Chinese. And about the etiquette of handling business cards, using a thumb and forefinger of both hands to hold the two corners at the top of the business card. And the front of the business card faces the other person. Here's a picture for your reference. Okay, that's all for my lecture today. Thank you for listening. 再见.
Thank you, Ting Ting. That was wonderful. I've lived in Asia for over 2 decades, and I can attest to the importance of familiarizing yourself with the culture. I hope we can all look forward now to putting these lessons into practice. A big thanks to all our speakers today. I hope you enjoyed the conference and have got a taste for the opportunities in China. You've met our staff, and you know that we are here to help you as you consider your options. If you have any questions or want any assistance exploring opportunities, please contact us. Email us at shanghai@investnorthernireland.com. Now to sign off, I'm going to leave you with a really moving video. At the start of the pandemic, a relationship was formed between Milburn Primary School in Coleraine, who recorded a song in Mandarin for the Chinese people who were at that time the first to experience COVID-19. Invest Northern Ireland's summer song worked with Chongqing Depu Foreign Language School, who recorded this after receiving messages of support from Northern Ireland. The video we're going to show you is, in essence then, the reply to that song, from China to Northern Ireland.
Are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the flowers are dying. Tis you must go.
We are the one, we stay together. We are the one, we stay together.
We are the one, we stay together.
Best wishes to Melbourne Primary School, to Northern Ireland and to UK.